So today I'm just going to sit down and talk to you about the surgery I got.
Open up and be honest about my bottom surgery and the things that I've been going through since I've had my bottom surgery.
I'm making a video that I've been meaning to make for a very long time. However, I haven't had the strength to do so.
I honestly thought I would never talk about this.
And I feel like after I had it, I kind of shut down and tried to push it away as much as possible and just kind of forget about everything.
In the short term, right when it happened, it was a really, really shitty experience. I'm genuinely one of the worst, scariest, and most painful times of my entire life.
Even though you share what you go through and everything, and you're really open about everything, there's some things that you are never gonna share.
Me personally, if ever I'm dealing with something, I usually just kind of shut down and go into myself.
Because I had a really, really hard time healing. I don't know if I ever really talked about it on here, but healing was really, really difficult for me.
It's going to be really hard for me to talk about this.
On the 3rd of November, I got my uterus and ovaries removed through surgery.
Yeah, I got the surgery about 3.5 months ago, mid-December.
So I had lower surgery back in January this year.
It's been almost 4 years since I had the first stage of my vaginoplasty.
And it didn't go as planned. So I'm just going to tell you my story and my experiences.
I was never gonna talk about it.
After my surgery, I was just in such a dark place that I didn't really want to talk about it.
So I didn't want to come on here. I tried, I couldn't.
I didn't really want to have to go back into it and feel all those feelings over again. So I just didn't.
But I wanted to make this video now because in a couple of days, I will be having revisions of my sex reassignment surgery.
Visual is not really how I wanted it to be. I am going to say that I am getting a second surgery.
Everyone's favorite topic, complications from sex reassignment surgery, SRS, gender confirmation surgery, gender affirmation surgery, whichever acronym or title you prefer.
About 50% complication rate. That means that out of people who have any kind of complication associated with phalloplasty, 50% of them, like half of them, will have complications which are from the pump. And a patient which has the pump implanted has about 70% complication rate.
The two most common complications when it comes to phalloplasty has to do with the urethra.
I encountered a few problems later on in the recovery that have led to me now needing revision surgery.
Because I have been suffering from complications for about 2 months now.
This isn't something that everybody having lower surgery will experience. I had some complications that led to this being a scary and painful situation.
One is a stricture, which is the narrowing of the urethra, and one is a fistula, which is a small hole in the urethra.
That's like my biggest fear. I never ever wanted this to happen.
A little disclaimer before I get into everything. I did have some complications and I did have some, concerns that not everybody deals with.
Before I start, I don't want to scare anyone. I don't want to stop anyone from getting the surgery.
I'm just very unhappy with the results, and that is not my surgeon's fault at all.
That being said, I want to make it clear that these complications were not at all a result of the way that my surgeons did my surgery. I stand by my surgeons to this day.
I don't blame the surgeon, I don't blame the doctors. It was just bad luck for me.
No fault of the procedure or anything like that, it's just things healed weird.
And because the surgeons are great.
Basically, I have absolutely no regrets about getting lower surgery. It has absolutely been the right decision for me. It's made me feel better about myself and just more positive and all of that good stuff that you want out of doing stuff like that, basically.
So the first day after surgery, you are on strict bed rest. You are not allowed to leave your bed at all. On the second day, they get you up, they get you moving around, and they start to build up your strength again. They start to get it so that you are able to walk around again. It's not until day 6 or 7, I think, that they take out the packing and you start dilating.
And that was like kind of the first time where I was gonna see how my body heals and how my body reacts.
And when my pain level was lower than it was when I woke up, they brought me back to my room.
When I got the surgery, I was happier than ever. As you guys know, I saw it for the first time and it was not pretty. My body healed in a way where everything healed so fast and my body wants to heal constantly. The visual is not really how I wanted it to be. I am going to say that I am getting a second surgery.
Normally, after this surgery, you can go home the next day, but I couldn't pee, so I had to stay another night.
So basically, I had an arterial bleed that required a second surgery to repair. I also had a refilling hematoma that got squeezed twice. Very, very painful thing to have done. I had no painkillers whatsoever. What came out looked disturbingly like blackcurrant jam, and I've not been able to eat it since.
Because, well, first of all, I've had some friends that have gone to her, and the results are great. And my body, it's, as I said, it's the first time that I've seen how my body heals. So I'm getting the second surgery. I made that decision when I got out of surgery. I was really happy to like lose that private area that wasn't part of me at all.
So I stayed over. There wasn't a problem. I could go home on Sunday, but when they checked me, they saw this. And I'm just going to show a picture because I don't know how to describe what they saw. But the picture says everything, so here's the picture.
Pump. So what are the complications? It could be the displacement of the pump inwardly towards your body. So it drags itself back in so that the penis doesn't look hard anymore, or only the middle, like half of it. The other complication is the dislocation outward. So the tip of the cylinder will rub through your skin.
I was completely happy. I was going on a trip with my friend and she had done the surgery, I think after me. So she was a couple months post-op. She had it way easier than me. I've had complications and I've had a hard time. And look-wise, I knew that I wasn't completely happy.
Yesterday, Jazz was getting progressively upset because her wounds were definitely separating and she formed like a blister. Like, it's almost like a blood blister.
As you can see, it was very swollen at my belly button, and that's not good. So they checked it and they said that I had to go to the hospital where my surgeon was working at that moment so that she can look at it. So my parents brought me to the other hospital and they checked me and they said like it's a little internal bleeding.
And I've basically never been in so much pain in my life despite having the maximum doses of painkillers that they could possibly give me. And I hate having surgery. Anesthetic does not do good stuff to me at all. I do react reasonably badly to it. And I had to be rushed down for a second emergency exploratory surgery because I was spurting blood from my groin and they weren't sure why.
But one suture got loose before they had to remove the complete sutures. And one was enough, basically. That's what happened. It got open, the wound got...
Around the 6 month mark, the scar tissue inside my vagina started to contract and go fibrous. So instead of it being stretchy, elastic skin, it started to feel a lot more like cartilage, that kind of feeling.
I'm having the worst time with dilation.
If you don't know, dilating is when you take a, basically like a medical glass dildo and you put it inside of you and leave it in there for like 20 minutes. It's like an ear piercing. If you don't keep the earring in, it'll close and it'll like seal shut. And obviously you don't want that to happen, so you dilate 4 times a day for the first couple weeks, and then you go down to 3 times, and you go down to twice a day, and then you eventually wean off of it.
Gradually go down. So I'm gonna have you take your hand and hold on to the dilator. And we can help you with the mirror. So first, just sort of point yourself to the dilator being there.
And my vagina started to contract and get incredibly tight, and it made dilation painful and prevented me using the larger sized dilators. No matter how much force I applied, it was just so tough and painful, and just no matter what I did, relaxation and easing up slowly, there was just no stretching at all. There was no give, absolutely at all.
We ordered a hotel room and we were there together and we would dilate together. When I removed my underwear and she looked at it and she was like, "I'm so sorry." That's when I like realized it should not be this way, and I wouldn't have to live with this after the surgery.
So first I just want to say, TikTok, this is educational. Second, a lot of post-op people don't really like that sort of language. Like, is it functional or natural? Or does it look real? Stuff like that. Because you're comparing it. Like, it's not a cis penis. It's a trans penis. So it is real. It's just a real trans penis. But yes, it's functional. It functions however you want it to. So if you want to be able to stand to pee through your penis, then you can get urethral lengthening. And I did. But most people, when they ask, is it functional, they mean, does it get erect? And yeah, if that's what you want, it can. But you have to get an erectile device, which is typically done in a later stage. So I'm going to get one, but it'll be in my stage 2. But yeah, it can get erect. And it can be all the way flaccid and all the way erect. So, yeah. But no hate, I know most people just don't really understand that because it's not talked about a lot, so.
As I said in the beginning of this video, I don't want to scare anyone. I don't want to stop anyone from getting this surgery.
But
I had 10 surgeries in under a year and a half. Do I regret having phalloplasty?
To give you like an image of like what's going on, when I stand up, my scarring has scarred so like fast and my body healed so fast that it's like indented in. So when I stand up, it looks like a croissant.
And that's when they found out it was an arterial bleed, and just, yeah. I ended up being in hospital for a week instead of 2 days.
Extreme pain, I would say level 9 out of 10. Like, I was passing out from the pain, almost passing out, while falling asleep from it.
But it's been difficult, like, going to the bathroom for me, like, in terms of, like, not as much as coming out. My bladder hasn't been emptying.
Jazz! Is it working? I don't really know how to pee. It's the same thing, Jazz. Just push.
I passed my peeing test. It was a little unusual, but I passed it. And the whole night, just the anxiety of them removing the stressing, that I couldn't sleep.
Run some water, but that always helps.
I don't know, nothing's really coming out.
Mom, can you come help me?
Yeah. Okay.
How'd that go?
That was a fail.
It was a fail.
But she learned that you can't throw sanitary napkins in the toilet.
That whole experience has made me terrified to have surgery again.
I sent a picture to Dr. Ting, Dr. Bowers, and he's going to make a decision right now if she's going to go back in the OR or not. I'm just like freaking out. I don't even know. So many mixed feelings. I'm like, this is not.
I'm really petrified.
After like 2 months, I was finally able to not only see a urologist, but see a urologist who's able to be like, hey, I know exactly what's going on. Let's do surgery next week. I'm like, cool.
I do not want to have surgery again. I don't want it. I really don't want it. And like, I'm scared about getting a phone call telling me that they have a date for me and
But fingers crossed everything goes perfectly. he said it's a very, it's just, it's simple. Just there's a couple of nips and tucks and just physically stretching me out from the inside, which he can do with a lot more force and skill whilst I'm anaesthetized than me trying to do it to myself.
You know, when I take pictures to like send to people or like guys or whatever, I position myself so that it looks fine. And they don't ever like question it. They're always like, oh my God, I love your coochie. It doesn't always look like that. Like I need to position myself to like assert a certain position.
So the worst part is over.
Which brings me to the more sensitive topic, which I already cried, so I'm probably gonna cry. I'm talking about my cavity, which is the coochie opening.
You know, I was a little surprised. Jazz is young and healthy, and normally patients like that heal really quickly. But instead, it just looked like the sutures were starting to spread, and the color of the skin right along the edge of the wound, you want it to be nice and pink, but it was looking dusky, kind of bluish, which can be a sign of too much tension, there not being enough blood supply. So I was pretty worried at that point.
Then that scar tissue does this cording thing and it starts like twisting and pulling everything and messing up all the nerves. This was causing pain all through here, all in my armpit, all down to here. I felt it all the way down in my right foot, all in my neck.
Like, I've talked about dilation before on my channel, and I feel like I haven't shown really how I feel and how I haven't shown how much trouble I'm having. I don't know what to do.
She's separated a little bit on both sides, which again, we did kind of know was a possibility. Yeah. That there wasn't a lot of skin, so I'm just worried that everything here is under a lot of tension. I don't want, you know, that last stitch to pop and then everything will just go, whoosh, you know, like a window shade.
So the next day, Tuesday, Monday, I got the emergency surgery for my internal bleeding, and Tuesday, I got to go home. I was feeling very, very, very sick. I was throwing up. I didn't know where to go with myself.
My friends that had the surgery at the same time as me, they're dilating like once every 3 days, and I am dilating twice a day.
Plus the way it just sort of rapidly got worse over the course of one day, that was like, oh, maybe we should just intervene early. Yeah. Taking to the OR will allow us to take a good look on the inside, really see what's going on.
I'm struggling to go to the bathroom. It often hurts. I have to go to the bathroom like multiple times an hour. I can't empty my bladder. Sometimes it's really painful. Sometimes it's not. Sometimes I wake up 5 times in the middle of the night to go to the bathroom.
It's led to recurrent UTIs, and despite drinking cranberry juice and cleaning and drinking lots of water, it's actually led to me having 3 quite bad kidney infections, which the pain of that is quite incredible.
It was really hard to move my arm. Everything was so swollen that my nerves were all getting pinched and all messed up. It was bad. It was really bad pain. It was some of the worst pain I've had in my life. It actually hurt way, way, way worse than my actual top surgery.
But there were problems, and that prompted a second surgery, which I was not a part of, unfortunately. Yeah, this has been a real journey, hasn't it?
Mm-hmm. So first, I just want to start and say my arm did not give me any complications. This was actually the easiest part. Next, I'm super happy to hear that your journey only took you through 4 surgeries in order to get to the end. That's awesome. However, unfortunately, my experience was very different. And of the 10 or so people that I personally know that also had the surgery, their experiences were also very different.
You know, we knew it would be tough. It turned out tougher than any of us imagined.
Taking Jazz on as a patient for surgery, we knew it was going to be a one-of-a-kind surgery. She's one of the first to have undergone complete pubertal suppression
and lack of growth of the skin and other tissues, which we rely on as surgeons to do this operation. And we don't have the experience of having said we've done 50 of these. I was just not expecting her to have a complication as severe as what she did have.
I had multiple complications, ranging from pulmonary embolisms to a urethral infection to staph, MRSA, septic shock, and ultimately C. diff. The C. diff led me to needing a fecal transplant in order to get my body back in health in order to actually heal from these surgeries. My journey is definitely a little bit unique in terms of how many complications I had, but my surgeon was quoting a 40 to 50% complication rate 4 years ago when I had surgery in 2017. I'm just here to share my true experience, the real information of what happened to me, and hope it can help anybody else that may want to go through this journey or is even thinking about supporting somebody who's going through this journey. Please remember, everybody's experience is different and we need to help each other.
I think in hindsight, we would have never sent you home from the hospital. You know, easy to say now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, I don't think I have let you guys know, but I have another repair surgery coming up, which is a bummer, but it is what it is, because I really, truly am still really happy with my decision to move forward with our FF phalloplasty that I did in April, but I have had fistula complications, so I had a repair surgery in August. I'm going to have a repair surgery on November 22nd. Hopefully that'll be the last of my repair surgeries, but the exciting thing about this next one is that Dr. Chen, my surgeon, has agreed to roll in a glansplasty into this repair, so when I come out, the little guy is going to have a little hood. But keep tuned in, like my page, comment, ask questions. I'm happy to answer anything that I feel is appropriate or find a way to answer it appropriately. But thank you guys for following and thank you guys for watching. Have a great day.
And I want to talk about this because I feel like with trans-related surgeries, it's like the reveals that I'm so excited announcing my date. Like, this is fantastic. Look at how much better my life is now. And that is all great.
When I wasn't here, when you had problems and had to go back,
mm-hmm.
I can't tell you how stressful that was.
And wonderful, and we need to see that. But a different side of it is that it's still surgery. Whether you're excited about it or not, whether it's going to change your life in a positive way or not, you are still doing something major to your body, and it can go wrong.
Under the circumstances, do you think it was important to you for a little mea culpa?
I'm not sure. You know, it's nice to hear I did something, acknowledging that. On the other hand, there's the medical side and an expectation that really should have been met.
So yeah, short story is I don't want surgery ever again, but I'm currently ballless and I don't want to be that way forever personally. I want the results of getting surgery again, like the next stages of lower surgery, but I don't want to do it again. And like, I know that in an ideal world, everybody would say they want the results of surgery, but they don't want to go through with it. But like, I have been so put off.
And considering that the type of bacteria, they will optimize my medication. So I already get antibiotics and they will optimize that. So hopefully all goes well, fingers crossed.
Having surgery ever again, because I'm really scared of that pain happening, and every time I think about potentially the next stages of surgery, I am like right back on that hospital bled. I am right back on that hospital bed having blood squeezed out of my groin. And I know that the chances that I would be unfortunate enough to have the same kind of complications again are low, but it could happen and other stuff could go wrong and you just never know, and I just don't want to do it.
You know, I'm surviving. I have a high pain tolerance. I put up with a lot of bullshit. I think that's just part of being transgender. You know, you're able to put up with pain. You're able to withstand a lot more. Kind of just used to pain and adversity. Used to pain both emotionally and physically. And I think trans people just are very strong in many ways, just from the process of having to go through so much to be themselves.
Hey, friend. So, no, I'm not exactly fully healed yet. I've had some complications along the way. I had my first surgery in April. I had some fistulas after that surgery, so I got a repair surgery in August. Unfortunately, only one of those two fistulas took to the repair method, so I'll be having another repair of that fistula upcoming this Monday. I'm also going to get a glansplasty, which means that they are going to create the head of the phallus, so that's really exciting. But the recovery process is different for everybody. Unfortunately, my body is taking a bit more time, so I'm not quite as far as I had hoped to have been, but I am being patient and I'm taking time because, Lord knows, I've already come a long ways in this process emotionally and mentally. So thank you for checking in.
And how do I do this for long-term benefits? It's important. So before you get top surgery, this is important stuff to know. This is important stuff to ask, because these effects can be really costly and they're super painful. So top surgery is a life-saving surgery for trans people. My life has been saved. I have absolutely no regrets at all that I got top surgery. No regrets ever. It was worth all of this pain. The nipple piercings, I regret it. But the top surgery, I hella don't regret it. So anyway, I hope that this is like somewhat informative and helps y'all.
I really hope that I have not like scared anybody shitless about getting surgery. Like, the complications I had are like uncommon, and like the likelihood is that you'll be fine. But at the same time, it's really important to talk about everything that can go wrong and show the kind of very serious side of the actual reality of getting surgery, and not just the kind of woohoo, I got a penis. If you guys have had like any kind of similar experiences, or you have some advice on how I can deal with this, that would be fantastic. Thank you very much. Thank you so much for all your support.
Yeah, this is my experience with the surgery. As I said in the beginning of this video, I don't want to scare anyone. I don't want to stop anyone from getting this surgery. I just want to share my story. This video was very hard for me to make, because it takes me back to all the hard moments that happened in the past 3 weeks. But I wanted to make this video and I wanted to tell you guys what happened. And as I said in the beginning of the video, I don't want you to stop this, let my video stop you from having this surgery. I don't want to scare you. I just wanted to share my story, my experience.